welcome to State of Affairs Live on GH1 TV. My name is Nana Abba Anamwa. You're welcome to the show. Tonight, we're wrapping up our discussion of the State of the Nation address, whether it was real or actual or whatever adjectives that have been used to label it. Tonight, we'll wrap up our discussion with Michael Quay Jr., who is Deputy Director of Communications for the New Patriotic Party, and also Sam Okudjeto Ablapa, who is Deputy Minister of Education, responsible for basic education. In the meantime, we've got some stories that have been making news throughout the day. We'll start with Guta, who have been on strike. But today, the executives confirmed they will end their three-day strike action. Guta and seven other unions who embarked on an industrial action since Monday, February 29, have, however, threatened to go on an indefinite strike should governments refuse to meet all their demands.
Hundreds of traders in Accra began a three-day protest from Monday, February 29, over tax and tariff hikes, which they say are crippling their businesses. At about midday, when the State of Affairs team got to Abosuokan, the hub of spare part retailing in Accra, majority of shops were closed. Williams is a trader here at Abosuokan.
Customers are very important for us, so the government has to see and reduce taxes so that we too can serve Ghana well.
Despite the ongoing strike action, some traders were secretly carrying out their businesses.
People come from a long place to find some parts, you know, if they are they are around. So if they come and we see that we can assist them to get some small thing that they want to buy, then we help them. That's why we are here.
Executive member of Guta, Siao Ampedu, assured the general public the strike will be over by close of today.
Tomorrow, we open the shops. Guta will meet at the Guta's head office and make analysis and evaluation and see what to do next. After 6 p.m., the strike is over. All the traders will come back tomorrow and open their shops and trade. But we are assuring them that we are not going to bow down to any negativities and or in the intimidations.
The unions had a meeting with the Ministry of Trade and Industry on Tuesday, March 1, where they expected positive results. The Ghana Union of Traders Association, Food and Beverages Importers Association, Ghana Automobile Distributors Association, Importers and Exporters Association of Ghana, Ghana Institute of Freight Forwarders Association, and the Customs Brokers Association of Ghana are the unions taking part in a three-day industrial action.
Well, we'll stay on that story and join the Director of Protocol for Guta, Richard Amamu, on the line now. Thanks for joining us this evening. If you can hear me, well, I believe we just lost him on the phone, but we'll go on to other stories if we get him. We'll speak to him to throw more light on what exactly transpired at that meeting. Now, the Electoral Commission has confirmed that Dr. Zenata Rawlings, the NDC's parliamentary candidate for the Klote Kole constituency, is not a registered voter. The EC made this known in a letter signed by its chairperson, Mrs. Charlotte Osei, to a private legal practitioner, Theodore Sori. The letter instructed him to represent them in court in a suit filed against Dr. Zenata Rawlings by the EC by incumbent NDC MP for Klote Kole, Ni Ama Ashiti. The letter confirmed that the records of the commission show that Dr. Zenata Rawlings is not on the commission's register and thus not a registered voter. The latest information comes on the heels of a suit filed by the incumbent NDC MP, Ni Ama Ashite, and one Ni John Coleman, who also lost in the November 2015 primary. The two pray the court to prevent Dr. Rawlings from holding herself out as a parliamentary candidate elect for the constituency on the ticket of the NDC, since she is not a registered voter. Now, we go back to our earlier story about Guta and seven others calling off their three-day strike and actually threatening to embark on an indefinite one if their demands are not met. And Richard Amamu is back on the line with us. If you can hear me this time around, what exactly transpired at the meeting and what were you told to convince you to call off this three-day strike? And exactly what are you expecting? And if you don't get it, would you embark on the indefinite one?
Thank you very much, and let me say good evening to your viewers. The outcome of our meeting was a matter of priority. We said that there are certain aspects of our demands that we think will go through parliamentary processes. And there are certain demands also which we think that government can do something about it, taking into consideration the 3% flat rate, flat rate, the ex-ware housing, the tax stamp, the post-clearance audit issue, and then the 1% on the charge on the CCV Act.
Mm-hmm.
We believe that 6-5, government can do something without going to parliament if really they wanted to do something.
And
so, yeah.
I'm sorry, but did you pick up from their posture in any way that they are ready to let go of these taxes you just took us through?
Yes, per the discussion and the decision, the Honorable Deputy Minister made it clear to us that he will be meeting the authorities that be, such that to have discussion with them, with a hope that they will look through these very five key points for us.
Okay.
So,
how much time?
That, you know,
mm-hmm.
Based on that, our strike is of twofold.
Okay.
We were saying that we have another aspect of it which will take a nationwide, it will be in a nationwide form. But the Honorable Deputy Minister pleaded with us that we can call the entire strike off. But we said that the only thing that we can allow is to call off the nationwide one with a hope that after having a discussion with the authority, it will come back to us with a favorable response. Mm. There and then, we can call the Accra strike also off.
All right.
But it promised getting to us as at yesterday night. Come this very morning, we were still waiting to hear from him. As of now, information getting to us means he's still talking with the discussing issues with the authorities. So okay. We have not had any tangible excuse or let me say any tangible information.
Okay. Now,
concerning what we discussed.
Okay, before I let you go, quickly, if you can tell us, how much time are you giving to government to resolve all these grievances you have put forward to them? Because we are thinking about this indefinite strike that you are threatening to undertake and the repercussions it would have on the country.
I can't hear you well, but I believe you are asking how much time you are giving to government.
Absolutely,
right?
Absolutely.
For us, we believe that those priorities or those points that we have settled on, government can do something about it. And if, as discussed with the Deputy Minister, and then thinking that he will get back to us, we are hoping that he will indeed get back to us with a favorable response. Other than that, come tomorrow, the strike is ended. Because we promised a 3-day, we decided to have a 3-day strike. But tomorrow morning, the executive will be meeting for the next line of action.
Okay, thank you very much.
We don't hear anything from the Honorable Minister.
All right, many thanks to you, Richard Amamo, who's in charge of protocol for Guta, talking to us about that indefinite strike they are threatening to embark on in case government does not meet all their demands. That includes the abolishment of certain taxes. Anyway, we'll move on to other stories. Now, a floating production storage offloading vessel, christened FPSO Professor John Evans Atta Mills, has arrived in Ghana. The vessel, according to a statement from Talo Ghana, is expected to start producing oil from the 10 fields by July or August 2016. The development of the 10 fields is being led by Talo Oil, along with its partners, the GNPC, Cosmos Energy, and Adako Petroleum Corporation and Petros Sir, the 10 partners, the FPSO Professor John Evans Atta Mills was constructed by MODEC and will be operated by MODEC Ghana Limited on behalf of the 10 partners. Now, in other news, the NDC has served notice that they will not take part in the upcoming by-election in the Ebuakwa North constituency. The by-election, which is slated for March 29, became necessary following the murder of the MP for the area, JB Dankwa Edu. According to the NDC, the circumstances surrounding the MP's gruesome murder that brought the nation to a standstill makes it difficult for it to contest. A statement signed by the General Secretary of the party, Johnson Isedun Ketia, read that the NDC does not want to benefit or does not want to be beneficiaries of a criminal act. The statement further urged supporters of the party in the area to channel the effort towards winning the elections in November for President Mahama. The NPP on Tuesday elected a tutor at the Akonsombo International School, Gifty Chum Ampofo, to contest the seat. And you know that, well, Independence Day is just around the corner, and we're being told that the president of Kenya, Uhuru Kenyatta, will be the special guest of honor at Ghana's 59th Independence Day anniversary. Now, the East African leader and one other who is yet to be named will join President Mahama on Sunday to review a national parade of school children, voluntary organizations and security services at the Black Star Square to commemorate the anniversary. The theme for this year's celebration is investing in the youth for Ghana's transformation. On Saturday, March 5, 2016, Vice President Kwesi Bekwanyemisa Arthur will host the annual President's Independence Day Awards at the State House, a statement from the Flagstaff House added. And before we wrap up to get into our discussion for tonight, the Africa Center for Energy Policy, ACEP as they like to be called, says government has added only 585 megawatts of power to the national grid, contrary to President Mahama's claim at the State of the Nation address that 800 megawatts had been added. ACEP also said the challenges in the nation's power sector have not been sufficiently tackled, as the president sought to portray. Speaking at a press briefing, Deputy Executive Director of ACEP, Ben Boache, said government cannot afford to be complacent as the power challenges are not over. The policy think tank also criticized the president for failing to touch on his promise to commission PricewaterhouseCoopers to probe the AmeriPower deal in his State of the Nation address. ACEP further recommended that government revert planning and power generation addition to the technical people at VRA instead of ministers. And that's it for the news this evening. We are taking a short break. When we come back, we'll be talking about the State of the Nation address. Well, it's a wrap-up of what has been happening since Monday, when Nanado actually read to the nation the real State of the Nation address and the rebuttal from the NDC's General Secretary, Johnson Isedun Ketia. Stay with me. My name is Nana Abba Anamwa. State of Affairs returns in a tad. Right, so you're welcome back to the show. My guest tonight, Deputy Director of Communications for the New Patriotic Party, Mike Okwe Jr. Mike, it's so good to see you.
Very good.
How have you been? Happy New Year.
Yes, by the grace of God, we're doing well. Yes, very happy
Independence.
New Year to you too.
Happy belated Valentine, everything.
Yes, we look forward to celebrating some more years of Ghana's independence.
Absolutely. And of course, the Honorable Samuku Jetua Blakwa, the Deputy Minister for Education. It's good to have you as well. And
good
all
to see
the
you,
best wishes as well.
Thank you, Nana.
All right. Okay, so Sam, I'd want to start with you. I'm sure you listened to Nana Akufo-Addo on Monday. And Nana Akufo-Addo sought to actually tell us the things that were missing in President Mahama's State of the Nation address. And as we listened through, and I'm sure the whole nation followed it, he made it clear that this government is everything but competent, really.
Well, let me say good evening to you, good evening to Mike and to our dear viewers. Certainly, I caught snippets of what Nana Akufo-Addo had to say on Monday when he sought to respond to President Mahama's State of the Nation address. It is important to emphasize that President Mahama's State of the Nation address is mandatory. According to Article 67 of the 1992 Constitution, every president must account to the nation through parliament, the people's representatives. You must present a statement on the state of the nation. So as for opposition leaders, really, they can decide whether they want to respond and all of that. So I'm not too comfortable with how he has dubbed his the true state of the nation address. Well, but this
because he thought that what President Mahama presented was not a true reflection of these subjective matters.
So okay. I mean that is from his view, and I am ready to grant him that. But I think that what the president presented, I mean, the president decided to make this edition of the state of the nation address an evidence-based state of the nation address, and not one of the stories the president presented, the people he brought to parliament. For example, in my sector, the story of Apim Shulamite, who had finished junior high school, gained admission to a boarding school. Her parents could not afford it. She lives in the Ekumfi district. Because they did not have a day school, she couldn't go to school and was selling wache and working in the chop bar. Apim Shulamite is now a student of the newly built J.E. Atamil's Community Day School, and is now the assistant school prefect in that school. You take the case of Jijo Kwamwa, another example in my sector, the education sector. A lady who had finished Ebri Girls, and Mike knows the story about Presec and Ebri Girls. We were in Presec, so we love Ebri Girls. She finished Ebri Girls, very brilliant girl, went for an interview for medical school. Unfortunately, she could not, you know how competitive it is. But here comes the University of Health and Allied Sciences, which President Mahama commissioned on the 19th of November, 2015. She is now pursuing her dreams to become a medical doctor, offering medicine at the University of Health and Allied Sciences Medical School. So when I hear those who have tried to rebut the president speak as though everything that the president has said is non-existent, Nana Akufo-Addo talks about a tale of two cities, and says that there is one city which is just President Mahama and his friends he invited to the public gallery.
In fact, he described that evidence-based approach you mentioned as an embarrassing exercise in mediocrity.
That is so unfortunate. I thought that he was very harsh and quite uncharitable to the president and to the people who came to parliament. These are ordinary Ghanaians who have come on their own volition. And you should see how excited they are.
The states didn't pay for them?
No, they were only invited.
They were invited. Where were they living? They came the same day.
I can speak for my sector. I was involved in hosting them. When they arrived, they passed through the Ministry of Education. I know the headmaster for the J. Atamil's at Atamil's Community Day School, came in with Apim Shulamite. I know that the Pro Vice Chancellor of the University of Health and Allied Sciences came in with the young lady, Jijo Akwamwa, on the same day, and they returned on the same day. It is such an honor. And this is not only Ghana that this happens. If you have followed President Obama's State of the Union address, he also does that.
He invites his guests.
I mean,
you did a parade.
There is no rule. That was not a parade. Not more than 20 people is not a parade. And even that, I have heard Nana Akufo-Addo, Mike Okwe, and others say that why only 20 people? There are 27 million
Ghanaians.
Yeah,
because Ghanaians. We want to know the sample size, you know, for instance. And that's a very relevant question.
But you have been to Parliament, you're conversing with Parliament, you know the size of the public gallery. And you also know that Parliament is controlled by the Speaker. The Speaker will give you a number of invitation cards. As the Speaker ruled last week, you know, when the minority leader sought to make an issue of this, the Speaker said that, look, we give out invitation cards and I do not determine who you give those invitation cards to. That's what he told the minority leader. But I think that the most substantial point is that, Nana Aba, let's be truthful to ourselves. Has the University of Health and Allied Sciences been constructed or not? It's a simple matter. We don't need Nana Akufo-Addo to verify that. When we go to Ho, we can see that. Has the University of Energy and Natural Resources in Sunyani been constructed or not? Has it been established? Are students there? As I speak, 2,360 students are attending university at the University of Energy and Natural Resources in Sunyani We have created 315 direct jobs. There are lecturers there. They are watching us. If this is a ghost situation, I mean, there are people living in Sunyani. They can tell us. Have we constructed community day schools or not? Are we providing 10,000 sandals or not?
4 out of 200.
Commissioned. There's a difference between commissioned and completed. There's a difference.
I heard
Nana Akufo-Addo say that at this rate, then it will take us forever.
Isn't that a relevant question to ask? If it's taking you 4 years.
We have set time with that number. Mm-hmm. The president repeated it at the State of the Nation address that 123 had various stages of completion. Some have been completed. As I speak to you, there are 14 of these schools that have been completed. Go to Dema in the Tano South District. Their viewers are watching there. They can tell us. Go to Chinderi in the Volta region. Your viewers are there. These schools have been completed. Okay. 14 of these schools ready for commission. The fact that a school has not been commissioned, President Mahama can even decide that he will stop commissioning and he can just instruct us that just enroll students. And there will be nothing wrong with it. Okay. What is important is that you are completing these schools. We see the rich hospitals. We see the roads. These days, as President Mahama said in his State of the Nation address, you wake up. By the time you go to work and you are returning, your road has been tired.
Really?
Yes.
Now, before I move on to Mike, let me ask you just a simple. It may sound very silly a question to ask, but for a president who is so tech savvy and he made copious use of projectors and slides during his presentation in Parliament, bringing in these people to Parliament, he could have done that with the slides without boring us with that number of people and the showcase we saw.
He did both. If you were in Parliament, you noticed that it was a PowerPoint presentation. Mm-hmm. He had pictures of the projects. But you see, President Mahama is also a storyteller. You notice that for every person, there's a story behind the person. He carefully selected them. All you right. Take the case of Jijote like this. She has a story, losing her mother at a young age of 10. And not having anybody.
And then there's
anybody.
A Zainab, a Muslim,
exactly.
Who is in Pigri.
You know,
and that's
well,
been picked up.
I have no confirmation if she's a Muslim. Okay. But you see, there's a story behind all of this. And you see, perhaps, perhaps, with hindsight, are we not beginning to see how so important it was for President Mahama to do what he did? Because even with all the people he brought to Parliament, even with all the pictures he showed, even with this publication, this Green Book, listen to what Nana Akufo-Addo is saying, that there are two tale of two cities. Listen to the MPP, that nothing is going on. So we need more evidence based. Okay. If you are living in a country with friends like MPP members who just can't see anything, when you have people with that kind of mindset, that kind of mentality, we need more evidence based approach.
Mike, over to you. Your response to all that he said.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. I want to start by saying that I think that one thing in politics is we all know about the Bible. A very compassionate John Mahama who thinks that he can break our constitutional rules and bring in two Guantanamo Bay people because of compassion should learn something from the Bible, which is love thy neighbor as thyself. Now, my brother Okudjeto Ablakwa talked about the fact that we say it's the real State of the Nation address, and so that is unacceptable, and so on and so forth. Now, I have in my possession, in 2007, the true State of the Nation, 2007. This was addressed by the NDC on Wednesday, 14th February, 2007, at the Kama Center, Accra. After President Kufuor's State of the Nation address, NDC came up with true State of the Nation address.
No, I've granted you that. I said you can do that. But that's what the president, he's obliged to do that. That is what I said.
Or if we want to play it back. He said, we are saying that is the real State of the Nation address and so on and so forth. I'm saying we learned from you. And we all know it's acceptable that you can come with true, we have come with real, same difference. So let us also try to talk to Ghanaians about what we think is the real State of the Nation address. Before I move on to a few things, I want to say that, yes, the evidence-based thing is fine. You can come up with one or two examples that you want to show for this and for that and so on. But by the same token, you could have also come up with examples that shows the way you squandered our money, for example. And that's what Nana Akufo-Addo said. He said they could have brought Woyume there to come and wave and say that, as he said, is it yesterday or the day before? He says he'll pay the money in 3 years.
Yeah.
Nanaba, do you think it is right that in this country you can be caught up in a corruption scandal? Like, not me, NDC Chief of Staff, Julius Debra, NDC Attorney General, Marietta Opombrew. Okay? They told us that there was a 1.9 corruption payment. When you steal a goat in this country, okay, even the judges who accepted goat, were they allowed to bring a goat back and left? Were they allowed to? But under NDC, refund the money. Refund the money. We're even told by NDC that one of the reasons why they don't want to go into the prosecution of it is that we are a poor country. What we need to do is take our money back, and then the prosecution is expensive. NDC. So the whole country is in a quagmire of confusion. We don't know where to go. This is happening here, that is happening here. But what is supposed to be the true state of the nation? Are we not supposed to talk about the economy? Because when you talk about the economy and the indices of the economy, then you'll be able to get a true picture. You can't come and tell me that somebody's rearing 7 pigs. And so the person should come to parliament and wave. Is that how serious we take our country? 7 pigs, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 is the example of Ghana moving on economically into the next level.
Well, considering if the person was involved in nothing and now has 7.
But you see, that's what I'm saying, the mediocrity. Because you see, what we are looking at, do you know that this program is part of LESDEP? Okay. And or part of LEAP, as I should say.
LEAP.
Because LEAP was before LESDEP. Do you know that President John Mahama, June 7th, 2008, in the graphic, not any paper, he said that LEAP is a lack of ideas, i.e. giving money to poor people is a lack of ideas. So for me, when you give money in LEAP, I thought he was going to come and tell us of the quantity of people whose lives it has changed. For example, here is one example here, but it has changed this amount of people's lives. And then you give us some of the areas that they've been able to invest the money in. But when you come with just one example and 7 pigs, excuse me to say, Mr. President, it is just too little and not enough. And I would rather term that as a lack of ideas under the circumstances. Now, when we talk about economy, what are we looking at? First of all, aren't we supposed to look at growth? The growth of our economy? Because in this country, 2011, our growth was 14%. My brother here, Okudjeto, was one of the people who was telling us how the growth had happened. And we were all saying that, look, it's even because of oil, it's a good thing, but maintain it. Then came 2012, 9.3 from 14. 2013, 7. 2014, 4. 2015, 4. We are growing at 4% as an underdeveloped country. And you're not ashamed? Or let's put it this way. You are rather so ashamed that you decided not to mention it and came to show us an economy of 7 pigs. That's what you came to show Ghanaians. An economy of 7 Zinabu pigs is your reference to show that the economy is booming. NDC, please, that is unacceptable. We have to look at issues like inflation. Because as for my brother here, his mouth those days was like olive oil when he talked about single-digit inflation. You remember? Oh, could you remember single-digit inflation? And it was a lovely song. We're all singing a song. But you remember when Dr. Baumia said, the figures are being cooked. And you cannot lie about your economy. As the great Winston Churchill said, when you lie about your economy, it's like a foolish man standing in a bucket and trying to lift himself with the handle of the bucket. You try imagine that. Your daughter or your son standing in a bucket and trying to lift himself with the handle of the bucket. Is it not nonsensical? Is that a way to deal with something? Is that not lack of ideas? Because you see, I want to borrow the words that Mr. President is comfortable with so that it won't be as if we are insulting anybody. Lack of ideas. You came and met inflation at 40%. Somebody within 8 years, MPP, they moved it from 40% to 18%. That's less than half, right? So NDC to moved it to 9%. And we say, good, you have halved it, stay there or bring it less. But minimum worst case scenario, even let's say 10. Now inflation is 19% under NDC after 8 years. President Mahama will not mention it. He'll talk about seven pigs and be doing us like this.
So you were expecting him to mention it.
He should mention and let us know the real state of the nation in terms of our economy. President Mahama will not tell us about the fact that now we have IMF policies where we are being told not to employ in government sector except in Mr. Okudzeto's area and health. Is that not the case? Are we not being looked at like school children with fiscal policy? In fact, right now, the World Bank is holding a cane over Mr. Okudzeto's back, lashing government ministers with cane in Ghana that they should behave. Because for them, they know that when they allow them the fiscal indiscipline, they will chop all the money in overinflated rebranding, this, that, and so on. So now World Bank is holding a cane and lashing NDC to watch the expenditure. But why have we gotten to this disgraceful place? Why the IMF is lashing Ghanaians with a cane? NDC HIPIC 2001. You know HIPIC fans are still coming into today, still lessening our debt. They don't say that. 2001, we went to HIPIC. If you don't qualify for HIPIC, IMF won't give it to you. 70%, okay, of our debt to GDP ratio. Okay. So we went for HIPIC. After 8 years, 92 to 2000, NDC, you gave us HIPIC. Then another group of people called MPP came and took over. After 8 years, Nanaba, you are the host, so it's not fair to let you repeat. But all Ghanaians will repeat, lower middle income economy. We are going higher. So when NDC came, if you can't keep the lower middle income economy, at least take it higher. But you worst situation, you bring it down to just the lower middle income economy. Within 7 years, we are now IMF bailout. And now, if you look at our debt to GDP ratio, in terms of our borrowing, look, 2012, what was our percentage? NDC, remember, 55% debt to GDP ratio. And I want to use under NDC so that there will be no confusion. There's a minister here. Then we go and look at the same NDC in 2014. It has moved from 55 to 67. 10% increase. Then from 2014 to 2015, you know what we have now? 70.7%, almost 71. And you know 70% means HIPIC. Ababase. NDC government. And you come and tell us about seven peaks. I mean, and what kind
things?
Of... Wow, but I want to stick on that, for example, because that was one thing a lot of people remember. I can't go into the distance of how many handkerchiefs came there to wave. I'll be wasting time again.
But you remember...
I don't remember how many, but they came there with handkerchiefs. And you see, when somebody's on leap, on less than 50 Ghana cities,
and the person has used it to transform her life.
You see, you're not understanding what I'm saying, Anaba. I'm saying your company here, if they employ one person and transform their life, it's not enough. If GH1, for example,
but it was representing a group.
No, you're forgetting what I'm telling you. What I'm telling you is that if GH1, your record was that, you used to employ 100 staff. And take good care of them. But within 10 years or 8 years, you are now employing only 5. Are you doing well or not? You are doing bad. Because when NDC came to power, there was no doomsday. Coca-Cola had not made people unemployed. The barbers who have lost their job, why didn't they bring them to parade them? The warrior that you paid that 51 million to, that was illegal. That he himself has even agreed to pay, that the Supreme Court said is create, loot, and share. Why didn't you bring warrior there to wave to Ghanaians? You should bring him there. You know the Gitmo too? Eh? Bernard Clef and his friend. Oh, compassionate Mahama. He should bring them to parliament to come and wave to Ghanaians. And you see the way the MPs run away from the chamber. They will run away from the chamber because they will even be afraid of them. You understand?
Okay,
but people that you will be afraid of to show us to wave, you went and brought them in compassion to Ghana. And when you make such a wrong decision, you say, but I'm the president. You don't know that your presidency is governed by law. You don't know that as a National Security Council, all security briefing must include the foreign minister and interior minister. And they say they don't know what happened. when she went to Parliament, closed door session, where they are supposed to keep confidentiality. She says she can't tell them because she herself, most of it, she was not there. Okay. So how did the president make that decision alone? Is that why we voted for him? It's a very serious matter. And President John Mahama must address these issues. Otherwise, the real state of the nation will check him.
Okay, so Sam, basically what he's trying to say is that President Mahama was very selective. He came to paint roses to us when he left out the thorns, which people are, you know, really experiencing in their homes, according to him. Why was he selective? If he was selective.
And I think you can also add that...
But before you say that, my brother, let us... Nana Basana, when you say, oh, what did Nana say before, it starts the confrontation. I think you can ask him, why did President Mahama not tell us about the economy?
No.
Then
you
it's
said,
direct.
You said, then he you talked about the economy, but you said...
No, he did not mention the indices.
He did.
Fine,
he
but did. It doesn't mean he didn't talk about the economy. So I'm just asking why President Mahama, according to you, was selective.
Yes, I was going to say, Nana, but I should also add that according to Mike, President Mahama was less humorous to be diplomatic.
Because, less humorous?
Yeah, because he says that President Mahama should have come with what you meant to wave him in I chop your money and well, to come with a gitmo too. I thought the State of the Nation address is a very serious exercise. And, you know, he's asking the president to veer into comedy. And I don't think that is what the State of the Nation address is about.
He was very comical. He was
Let me respond.
And laughing at his own jokes.
Let me respond to a number of the issues he has raised, which are the same old, you know, we've heard and heard and heard. First of all, it is not true that President Mahama did not talk about the economy.
Good.
I have the statement here, pages 17 to 20. He focused on the economy.
Did he mention inflation?
He mentioned other figures.
Like,
did he talk about inflation? That's one of our major indices, isn't it?
No, what is this inflation? Mm. Economists will tell you that sometimes you can decide to consciously let inflation go up to stimulate your economy.
But is that what we are
doing?
It
is not necessarily the case that when inflation is down. It depends on your economic management strategy.
But is that what we are doing? Are we deliberately?
Where we are now. I'm surprised that Mike Okwe's MPP's best inflation figure is the same figure where we are now, 18%. That is the best they could do.
And you from 18,
is the best
you
they
can't
could
go
do.
To 19.
We have the record. You have just confirmed here that we have the records of the longest single-digit inflation period where President Mahama was the chairman of the economic management team. I mean, we have that record. We have the highest growth rate in the Fourth Republic. So I'm surprised you want to go into a debate on economic indices when you know you cannot win. We have a superior record. The fact that there is a global economic meltdown now, and growth has slowed down generally, and we have challenges. But even that, many countries in the world today would be so excited to grow at even 2%. We are growing at 4%, and the mid-term prospects are very good. In any case, when we talk about the economy, what do you think is important to the ordinary Ghanaian? It's not these figures, these indices. Are you creating jobs? That's why if you look at the president's focus on the economy. He focused on job creation. How he has given 50 million Ghana cedis to the pharmaceutical sector, and they have generated jobs. He talked about how he has instructed us at the Ministry of Education to ensure that all the textbooks are printed locally, which will generate 1,400 jobs. That is what the economy is about, empowering the people. Then he talked about the $7 million gold refinery, which has been inaugurated. These are the things the president is talking about. That is what is of essence, of importance to Ghanaians. And then when it suits them, they say that they dispute some figures. This single-digit inflation, I'm happy that today they come to accept that we did it. The high growth rate of 14%, which they were questioning. And even right now, as he spoke a while ago, he still sought to cast doubt. In that same breath, he's saying that we have not been able to maintain our record and our reputation. I mean, you can't just get what he's talking about. Then he also makes the claim that in the fight against corruption, all we are doing is calling people and asking them to refund. And then pay in installments, add them to go scot-free. Jesus Christ. Mike, are you in this country? As we speak, our own colleague, Member of Parliament, Honorable Abugapele, is being prosecuted under the JIDA revelations. As we speak, over 100 personnel of the National Service Scheme are being prosecuted. They were fined only last week. They have been successfully prosecuted.
They were what?
They have been fined.
Fined?
Yes. They were asked to refund the money with interest by the courts only last week. We didn't just call them in our homes and say, hey, young man, you know, try and pay back by installment. That is not what happened. So you can't just generalize because there have been a few. Even Woyome, that you cite. It is Woyome who is saying, I'll pay back in 3 years. Who has really listened to that? Is it not being prosecuted? The current Attorney General has mounted such a vigorous prosecution of Mr. Woyome.
Is it vigorous, though?
And everybody knows that. Everybody knows that. That she's even gone on appeals when Woyome has won against the state and all of that. So to say that people are just being called and being asked to refund, no, it is not fair. If there have been one or two cases where that has been the conclusion, you can say that. And I know you are talking about the bus branding case. But it is not true that every case of corruption, we ask the people to refund. It is the same blunder that Nana Akufo-Addo committed
when Nana Akufo-Addo
said that, how can President Mahama say he's fighting corruption when it is always the media that exposes the corruption? So he does not see the committee of President Mahama. Again,
in fact,
that,
he said the media and the opposition.
Yes, that is palpably false. There are so many. The National Service case, President Mahama himself asked the BNI to go and look into it. National Health Insurance, which is going on now. President Mahama, a whistleblower came up and he asked them to go and investigate. So it is not true. The World Cup Commission report, President Mahama on his own volition set up the commission, and that is what unearthed a lot of what happened. The JIDA, President Mahama set up the committee. And that is how come we got to know what had happened with JIDA.
So where are the monies? If all of these have been instituted, where are the monies?
Nanaba, you are in this country.
Yes,
the Attorney General has reported to this country regularly on how much is being paid.
But I asked you a question that you
last year the president addressed this nation on Anti-Corruption Day, and
yes,
I remember he gave a breakdown of how much has been retrieved from JIDA, from SADA. And these days, I notice they don't talk about Suba any longer. When Nana Akufo-Addo listed, Suba is their newfound friend. They wanted them to get a new contract. But you see, let us say that.
What is happening to
President,
the AG's report
President,
on the bus funding saga?
President, the AG's report has been acted upon. President Mahama announced in the State of the Nation address that the first installment has been paid.
That's 300,000 cedis.
Yes,
well,
300,000 cedis
many
has been paid
that
out of
flash
the,
in the pan.
But they are paid.
Can it be made public? Can we see what exactly the report said?
It's a good call. I would also love to see the report. As it is now, the report is between the Attorney General. You know, the Chief of Staff asked the Attorney General to prepare the report and it was presented. Let us admit that it's not all reports that are for public consumption. But as has been very consistent with President Mahama, I will not be surprised if he orders that the report should be made public. I don't know if they are waiting for the refunds to be completed before the reports are made public. But I would also love to see the report, and I'm sure that most Ghanaians would love to see it. And I will not be surprised if the report is declassified and put out there. But I think that, let us be truthful. Is President Mahama saying that he has created paradise? He never said that. Even when he talked about the schools and the trees which we inherited from the MPP, he said it's 60% which we have eliminated. There is 40% out there in the fields that we need to eliminate. He has never said he has created paradise. Indeed, if President Mahama is so convinced that he's created paradise, he will want to leave now when the applause is loudest. Why do you think he's going for a second term? Because he knows that there is more to be done. That despite all the hospitals, the roads, the schools, the clinics, the massive infrastructure all over the place, the jobs that he's creating, he still has the passion to do more, because there's so much that needs to be done in this country to bring our people out of poverty, to improve on their living conditions. That is why President Mahama is seeking for another term. So he is not just out there painting a rosy picture or saying that all is well and okay. that he has created paradise.
I'll let Mike come in here before we delve into the issue of energy. Mike, your response to what he just put across.
Sometimes, anyway, I was very tempted to butt in sometimes, but so that the program could flow, I had to hold back a bit. Wayume, do we remember what happened in this country when the Wayume saga broke out? How members of government, some presidential staffers, some even deputy chief of staff, were defending Wayume in this country? We've forgotten. Have we also forgotten that this same NDC who today are telling us that they prosecuted what? Isn't it Martin Hamidou who took it? And even that, what happened to Martin Hamidou afterwards? Was he not sacked for so-called insubordination or whatever? The person who took it to court? Were they not forced, arm twisted, to take Wayume to court? And today, you come and sit here and say you wanted to take your money and all of that. Jida, do we not remember that it came from the Auditor General's report? And they were forced to investigate that the government of Ghana could lend money to an individual interest-free. Nanaba, have you heard this before in the world? That you are a lender, you lend it to your friend interest-free. NDC did that with our money. They told us they have gone to pay for a confirm. Was it they who brought it out? It was the AG's report, not the Attorney General. And they told us that they are confirmed. When Metro TV went there, they said, where are the beds that are confirmed? Then he said, oh, sometimes they are confirmed. They go and eat in Burkina Faso. So a confirm had all flown to Burkina. And then the Metro TV camera just went into the sky and there was no anuma. Lofloko bet Kamrami. NDC did that. So for them to now come and sit here and try to claim credit. World Cup, you are a sports person yourself. You know a lot about sports journalism. Elvis, a free anchor. When all this mismanagement of the money and the players were rebelling and they had to fly money, millions of dollars in an aeroplane, was it the government of Ghana who did what? So when they came, there was already alarm blow. And what happened to Elvis, a free anchor? Is he not in Flagstaff House? Chilling on ice over there? So don't bring the issues and let me even...
Has any report sought to portray him as a corrupt person?
Do you remember the report that came and said that they were they had been indicted and they should pay back the money? Yes.
The Price Waterhouse.
I don't know about that. I know about the judge. Is it appeal or something? They said they should bring the money back. That's what they said. So once they say you should bring the money back, remember this was a civil procedure. So now there can even be a criminal procedure that will follow. You remember with Wayume, there was a civil procedure. We talked about the create, loot, and share. Then now the criminal had to start. Do you see the problem? Create, loot, and share. Nana, but you didn't say it. Oh. Not a journalist. MPI didn't MPP, we didn't say it. PPP, CPP, PNC, they didn't say it. Supreme Court judge says, you, Okudeto, your government, they do create, loot, and share. Somebody will create the awam, then they'll loot the money, then they'll share between you because they didn't share some with journalists and with opposition. This is the verdict. So when we are talking about the fact that corruption galore and this, don't even attempt. Somebody asked President John Mahama, I remember, says, a journalist.
You have no moral rights. The NPP has no moral rights.
Oh, that's what Mr. Sidin Ketia, you say it how he likes. But let's ask the question. They say, oh, we are uncovering the corruption. So we are not at fault. If there's no corruption, what will you be able to uncover? You cannot discover what is not covered.
They're not shelving it.
You don't understand what I'm saying?
I understand.
The corruption is so boomful. Yeah? That apart from what is being discovered by Auditor General, being discovered by opposition, being discovered by journalists, even they are discovering some. Because near FA Agbotontoli, plenty corruption. You see the thing? It is now corruption galore. That's the problem. So we want Ghanaians to know that when there's corruption galore, of course, you will unearth millions and millions of that. But what are some of the untruths that were told by our president? And these are the issues that we are talking about. The president tells us that, oh, Takwa Bogosu Road. You know that road?
Mm.
Mentioned it. Nanaba. Nanaba. Do we not know in this country, in Ghana?
We'll be looking at roads very soon. Oh, let me take some messages.
Let me just land on this, on my point. Because if you talk about roads, I can remove this and talk about it. We can talk about hospitals.
We'll talk about health. We'll talk
very
about
good.
Energy.
Then we'll talk about...
We have about only about 25 minutes to go.
Okay, then in that case, I'll hold my horses. So
thank
that you
very
can
much.
Something.
Let me take some social media messages. I mean, when is government opening vacancies in senior high schools? This is coming from Nana Mensa Thompson. Samuel, would you want to answer that quickly?
We have already, actually. So they should bring in their applications to any regional director or to the Ghana Education Service or the Ministry of Education.
All right.
Can I also answer one?
Yes.
Look, he knows they can't create any jobs like that. IMF is holding a cane. No. Look, let me just add this. As for Sammy too, let me tease him a bit. Sammy cannot tell us about jobs in this country. Why? Because Sammy at one point, he told us that they've created 1.8 million jobs.
And we defended it.
Then the employment minister, remember?
He had no...
He was a new minister. He said he needed time to prepare properly. No.
Okay.
He had been invited to parliament on another question. And right. he said that
the
they
minister
should
says Sammy don't
properly.
Know what he's talking about. Okay.
No, he never said that.
Right.
He never said that.
Okay, let's move on. Honorable Peter Adega says we need another alternative. We can't trust the NPP. This is coming from Peter Adega. DY says when it comes to job issues, these guys are really funny. How many years have they been ruling this country, and how many jobs have they collapsed? And they're talking about the NDC government. Peter says, what is the NPP's message? The size of the economy in 2008 is different from now. We must stop comparing. There's another one. Interesting conversation between Mike Okoye and Sammy Okudjeto. They're always very interesting arguments. Humorous, simple illustrations, though, and really, really enjoyable. Cosmos says, Mr. Blackwa, you said the state of the nation address is very serious. It's a very serious issue. And your president spoke about only 7 picks. Well,
and many more things. 1,400 printing jobs, jobs in the pharmaceutical sector. Hundreds of jobs in
the gold
refinery sector.
All right. You know, there's another one here from Mensa Duku who says that Mr. Michael Kwe, the president spoke about very important issues and we Ghanaians appreciated it. Mumuni Abdul says, has the government created any jobs at all? Well, those are some messages. That there are several of them, but keep the conversation going. State of Affairs is the hashtag to use on Twitter, Facebook, and other social media platforms. We're taking a break. When we come back, we'll talk about energy and if really the president has fixed the power crisis.
Every time you call, text or browse to Enjoy spa treatment, restaurant treats, discount on car purchases, and so much more. Dial *566# now.
Airtel, the smartphone network.
Okay, you're welcome back to the show. Before we talk about energy, Sam, this is one contradiction I found in the President's State of the Nation address. In just last week, Thursday, he said that in 2015 saw an active NHIS membership of 11.2 million, that's 41% of the population. Outpatient utilization of the NHIS rose to 29.6 million in 2014, from 597,000 in 2005. In 2015, this is what the president said, outpatient utilization of the NHIS went up to 27,400,000. The figures are so different.
No, take the figures again. I didn't get it.
I'll do it again.
Yes.
Okay. So this is the president in 2016.
Yes.
He said 2015 saw an active NHIS membership of 11.2 million. That's about 41% of the population.
Yes.
Outpatient utilization of the NHIS rose to 29.6 million in 2014, mm-hmm. from 597,000 in 2005.
Yeah.
Now, this is him in 2015. Okay. He said outpatient utilization of NHIS went up to 27,400,000 in 2014. Mm-hmm. So he gave us two different figures on outpatient utilization of the NHIS from the same year. So how is it possible that 2014, we have a different figure in one breath, and then in another breath, we have 27.4? He didn't update his notes. Somebody must have checked, no?
No, you know, it depends on which quarter of the year you're reporting on. If you look at, I'm sure that you are referring to the launch of the accounting to the people book, and
your
I have
Bible.
It here, page 29. Yes, we just love this book because the MPP trembles.
Really,
the outpatient utilization of the NHIS rose to 29.6 million in 2014 from 60.6 million in 2009 and 597,000 in 2005. Mm-hmm. So that is the figure. You know, sometimes some of these figures, when the State of the Nation has been put together, you may either be looking at half year or a quarter might be out, so that may explain.
So that could be responsible for that.
Yes.
Okay, I was just wondering.
Yeah.
Anyway.
But if I could respond to some of the issues that Mike has been putting out.
Then you have a third bite on it.
No, you had all the time. No, you were on the floor.
She's now moved to health. Unless we are going back.
The health was just by the way. I'm going to talk about energy.
Maybe I shall have a bite of the health cherry as well. But you I can
respond quickly, Sammy, and if you want us to do no, but you can't get away with all the things you have said.
When you
know that.
No, but you must control. Otherwise, we can keep going back. I don't mind.
No.
Why are you scared about me rebutting all the things?
No, he's not scared. Third bite of the cherry.
No,
okay. Sam, quickly, you have 30 seconds. Please.
Mike knows very very well that the MPP can't be talking about corruption.
Why not?
As my general secretary said.
Why not?
You are talking at judgment debt. Nana Akufo-Addo wrote to the attorney general that the Great Cape Company should be paid. Are you forgetting about that? That the Great Cape, you are talking at Credit Loot and Share. He wanted to participate as well, if that is what judgment debt is about.
But if you
are a lawyer and you know that judgment debt is given by the court, it is not an issue of just Credit Loot and Share.
Please.
There are instances where some have gone wrong. That is why the president set up the Judgment Debt Commission. But Nana Akufo-Addo wrote a letter to the Attorney General. I was at the Ministry of Information. We made this public. Great Cape Company that paid them. If judgment debt is Great Luton, why did he want to come and also
talk? If it's really true, why haven't you instituted any?
Apart from that, when he was foreign minister, the land for the foreign ministry at the airport residential area, they sold it. We had to come and rescue where the foreign ministry is today. We had to come and say no. This land is part of our heritage. It used to be the international student hostel. Jake's bungalow, have you forgotten? If every minister who lives in the bungalow. Every minister who lives in the bungalow.
It went to court.
Yes,
it
went to court. Yes, it went to court. Did you read the court judgment?
Yes, I did.
Yes.
Yes, and you saw the moral issues that were raised. And the court actually even said, I was a party in that. The court said that we should go to Shraj, that is the proper forum. But we just thought that we would leave it.
We will leave it to the conscience of the nation.
You think it is proper to buy your bungalow where you live? If every minister was buying their bungalow, what would be left?
Mike.
Thank you very much for mentioning my name.
School feeding program. You remember the rot at the school feeding program? That is why the Dutch government withdrew. So as for corruption, there's a litany to the extent that it was so much.
But if they are so
the corruption was so bad that President Kufuor said he had to create a secret office called Accountability Office so that they will be checking themselves.
Why haven't you prosecuted even one person?
We prosecuted. Prosecution doesn't lay in our hands. It's for the courts to...
So then they did nothing wrong to decide. So one person, the court said...
The former foreign minister... There was a judgment against him. And he was supposed to refund money. Okay. I forgot in the
Mike,
Rice
over
case.
To you.
The
Mike.
Former foreign minister. Okay, Mike, a cabinet over cabinet
you.
Minister.
Mike, over to you.
You see, when Sammy came, he was really composed. You know, his tie was very tight. Nice. All of a sudden, he's lost his composure.
I'm so composed.
He threw his hands away. He's fidgeting.
Are you watching the same program?
Don't worry.
It's becoming a tale of two
you
programs.
You stop fidgeting and let me go on this. First of all, with the Nana and the Great Cape case. The Great Cape case, there was a chap who had to be paid by government for a broken contract for a deal in 1998. In 1999, the Attorney General then, who was, if people don't remember history, NDC, said he should be paid. When MPP came, they were wasting time that the man should be paid. Then Nanado said, hey, if they say he should be paid since 1999, why are you wasting time? Pay him. They say Nanado has agreed to judgment debt.
I thought you said judgment debt is create loot and share. No.
There are some judgment debts that are create loot and share. That's the example.
Okay. Thank you.
We are not saying all judgment.
Okay. I don't know.
Because if it was create loot and share, the NDC... AG who decided in 99 should know.
But NPP makes it look like every judgment.
No,
yes.
That's what I'm saying. No, but they have got it wrong. We are saying that there are judgment debts which are legitimate. Oh, that's no problem with that.
This is a major shift. It's not a shift.
It's not understood.
This understanding is different from a shift. This is breaking news. Now we are back on the same page. That's good.
Now listen, let me make this clear again. And I'll say this as a lawyer of the Supreme Court of Ghana. That not all judgment debts are create loot and share. Okay. Even some judgment debts under NDC, they are not create loot and share.
Okay.
You understand? There are some which are create loot and share. For example, Woyume, African Automobile, those ones. Those are create loot and share. And the judges have spoken about it. So let us not go there. Now, talking about land. Do you know that if you are a minister of a department, you are not in charge of government lands? Do you know? Because some people don't know. But Ghanaians should know that if I'm a minister of trade, I am not in charge of all the trade lands. So there's a lands department, isn't there? So if they go and sell foreign affairs land, and me, Nana Akufo-Addo,
cabinet minister,
knowing me as usual, I didn't even take any of the lands. Nana Addo is on record. He doesn't accept per diem. The per diem that people like Haruna Idrisu have been accused of overchopping. It's an accusation. But we don't know whether they're alleged.
I'm just giving you the example. We're also accused
somebody
of buying
like
Nanado,
you can be the hostess. You let me give the example. And for example,
I'm just telling
yes, for example, Nanado, per diem, he said, I don't like. They give him petrol coupon, he said, I don't like. They give him allowances for his house. Nanado, he said, he don't like.
Dr. Dufour, the power minister, never took all of those things.
So let's put Nanado in that bracket and not try to
debase. But he couldn't protect the land. He couldn't protect our heritage.
I need to respond to that quickly. So in a nutshell, that wasn't the case. Then the last one, Jake's house on the land. Madam, do you know that it is NDC who brought the policy of the fact that you can buy your own bungalow when you leave office?
It's not true. It is not true. There is no such policy. There is no such policy. Mention one minister. Mention one minister who bought bungalow. Have you forgotten this country, the true ministers out?
My brother is all GT.
You remember?
Why are you so hot?
When you came to about 2001.
Take it easy.
You remember how you drew ministers out of their bungalows?
No. You cannot lie.
I remember very well. Under Benyuad Do, in the middle of the night.
Quickly, Mike. Thank you.
If the Supreme Court realized that what Jake has done was illegal, would they not have said so? They said it's the law. So if you brought the law that allowed him to buy the bungalow, you don't turn around and say somebody who has used the law to buy his bungalow.
On the basis of morality.
Then they should have used morality before they use the law.
Okay.
So it means that NDC is an immoral party for bringing that law. If that's what you're saying.
What law is that? But, quote the law.
Oh, okay. Please.
You are a lawyer. Quote the law.
I can do the research.
You are now going to do the research.
Yes.
Okay. All right. We have just a few minutes to go, and I've got Beneficence Countdown coming up. But I want us to touch on energy briefly, because Ronaldo said something that I found quite instructive during his address.
Oh, you found something instructive?
Yes, I did. Wow. I found a lot of things instructive.
Really?
Yes, just as I found a lot of things instructive in President Mahama's address as well. Yes, I did. Man. Okay, so it's about the president saying that he accepted responsibility in 2015. I want to read that part of his speech in 2015 to see if indeed he accepted the responsibility for the energy crisis. Okay. He said that, as I present the State of the Nation address, our nation is confronted with one of such hail, the challenge of providing adequate electricity to power industry, business, and for residential consumption. The effects and frustrations posed by the power deficits are clearly felt in our workplaces, our homes, schools, hospitals. He goes on and on and on. Okay, this is where I want. We have been here before, in 1983, 1998, 2006, and 2007. We suffered a similar occurrence. In the past, what we have done has been to manage the situation. I do not intend to manage the situation as has been done in the past. I intend to fix it. I owe it to the Ghanaian people. I, John Dramani Mahama, will fix this challenge. Is that an acceptance of the crisis, of the responsibility that indeed I am somehow responsible for what we are going through?
Of course, Nana. I mean, you are a very intelligent journalist. That is it. There can be no other interpretation. He took responsibility. And that is why he forced our general secretary to want to, you know, wonder what was happening.
Is this the same English?
He took responsibility. He says, I will not manage. I will fix it. So he took responsibility. He says, I will fix it.
Okay.
Unless there's another meaning for responsibility.
So by saying I will fix it, it meant that he was responsible for what we had gone through.
He didn't pass the buck at all. Yes.
Well, he said it.
And even in this State of the Nation address, do you remember that he was at pains to let Ghanaians know that he empathizes with them and that he will ensure that this never happens again? I pledge to Ghanaians that I'll continue to work to ensure that we never find ourselves in such a dreadful situation ever again, unquote. I wish to thank Ghanaians for your patience
really
and understanding.
Has the energy crisis been fixed, Sam?
I mean, as for energy crisis, you can't hide. When the do-so comes, it will expose
because
you.
We are told this is cosmetic.
So
it cannot be sustained.
The light is on and they say it's cosmetic. There's cosmetic light and there's real light. Well, they are the energy experts. What I know is that we are enjoying light now, what the president promised that he would do. And you can see that the president has made massive investment in the sector.
He says right 800 megawatts has been added. ASEP today says it's 580 and not 800.
I mean, that's ASAP's opinion. I mean, everybody is entitled to their opinion. We all know where
ASAP... How can that be opinion? Where, it's a statement of fact.
We all know where ASAP is coming from.
And, where are they coming from? Is it one of the NPP sponsors?
Yes, we all
really?
Know.
Really?
Oh, they are my good friends. They know. I mean, their leader, former MC for Tamale, Honorable Amin Amta. He's my very good friend. He was Nook's president. His deputy was an MPP DCE.
All right.
So, I mean,
Mike,
we know, and we grant them that. It's not a crime that if you are MPP, you can't form an NGO.
Mike, please come in so that
Thank
I go for
much.
The countdown.
Now, I find it strange. You see, your father leaves you 7 houses. And as an, I won't use the word irresponsible.
You really like 7. If it's not 7 pigs, it's 7 houses.
Leaves you 7 houses.
He's looking for 7 kids.
And you come in there and sell 3. Then eventually, you go and rent 3 more houses, and then you say that they should clap for you. Ah, when President John Mahama and President Mills, because it was a Mills-Mahama administration, right? When they came in, was there doomsday in this country?
No, not that I remember.
Now,
but there had been Dumso in 2007.
2006 and 2007.
Yes, yes. Everybody accepts responsibility for their time.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Let's not go into what happened in Rawlings' time as well. Or whatever. That's
then,
not the issue.
Uh-huh. Okay. Then don't say that there was no Dumso.
When you took over, we were not experiencing any power shortages.
But because it has been cyclical, as the president has always said.
No.
83, 96, 2006, 2007.
And then you took us 4 years.
Because as for the MPP one, everybody knows that it was because of Akosombo.
Oh.
Yes, Akosombo drought.
Oh, but ours, Akosombo wasn't.
No, yours, Akosombo drought and financial mismanagement.
Really?
Oh, that's why you remember the number. Let me tell you. You remember in the peak of Dumso, when we were watching the World Cup, we had light.
Yes.
What happened? They went and bought power. If Akosombo was down, as for that one, you think God can make rain fall only during World Cup? They know they mismanage their economy and the energy.
So during your doom, so you need to
let me show
Ghanaians that
I want to protect his reputation. You know, I like him very much. The way he's going, you know,
my brother, this is such a slip. What I'm saying is that if they could fix doom, so for us to watch football, they could fix doom, so for us to have the industries working.
We have fixed
but it. Because fix what? Put me my air ball. Football, you could let us watch.
Why if are you the going rain to history? Was down, we are talking
now.
We have fixed it now.
But do you think it's been fixed? President Mahama says he's fixed it, and we are really,
now,
really.
Now,
I mean, my
now,
lights haven't gone off.
No, now let us. No, there's no problem with that. My lights have gone off, but don't worry about
it. Can't you commend the president's
the problem is this. Do you know that when NDC came to power, one of their biggest decisions, okay, was stalling of the gas. You remember when they moved from Pohnrei to Atuabo? Something that was supposed to have been completed in 2010 took an additional 3 years. And we know that gas was one of the problems for Dumso. Now who caused them? Two, because of financial mismanagement, they were not able to give the money. Do you know the amount of money that the government owes ECG? And ECG in turn owes VRA. Government owes ECG 500 million. VRA is owed 250 million.
Do you know how much of that is your government? Do you know how much of that we inherited?
I'm coming.
Do you know how much of that we inherited?
He needs to let me land because I just want the viewers to listen.
If
the government had paid ECG that money, they would have paid VRA. We won't have done so. But they have rather mismanaged their money into giving all the 600 million plus in areas like judgment debt. They didn't have any money.
Let's go for Benefson's countdown now.
That's the problem.
You're so predictable.
Well, yesterday, if you support NDC and you were laughing at the MPP's problems, today is your turn. The NDC have their share of the problem the MPP is having. Even the MPP is better in terms of two factions, Kufuor faction and Akufo-Addo faction. The NDC, they've got three factions, which is very dangerous. Dangerous in the sense that you can never have the three factions each channeling their own course. You have usually two against one. You have the Mahama faction, Mons faction, and the Rawlings faction. These are factions that replicate themselves in various issues, appointments, decisions being taken. But usually when the government is in power, it is able to paper on the differences. So if you're in NDC, I'm sure you know where, if you're watching me, your constituency, your region, or even your polling station area. These are little differences that happen. The NDC is lucky. The NDC is based on personalities, while the MPP is based on more of the Ashanti and Akyem factions. But that's for NDC. These are the problems you have on your table. Even twins who spend most of their time together in their mother's tummy, they have differences. The tongue and the teeth and your mouth, they have differences. They bite each other once in a while. So differences in the political party is not unique. But how to resolve it is the important thing. By the time the Elections Commission opens the date for filing, July 18th and 19th, we'll talk more about that later. Then you'll be able to see why the ruling party has been able to solve its problems adequately. Yes, there is a committee, conference resolution committee, to try and soothe issues. You know, like if somebody has taken the party to court over the party's primary, one, he'll be disqualified automatically. And if he knows he or she'll be disqualified, he or she is going to be an independent candidate. And if it's a swing constituency, the NDC is likely to lose that seat. So we'll know it will affect them, but how fast that committee works will determine whether the NDC will be deeply affected or not. Well, I'm sure that your panelists will want to comment on the problems in NDC, because everybody talks about problems in NDC. Now we've thrown out the problems in the NDC. How will the panelists take it? Lanaba, over to you.
Sam, straight to you. You have problems in your party. You have factions. I didn't know you have three factions. They never dawned on me.
Yeah, I'm also finding out for the first time. You know, Uncle Ben is somebody.
You mean you know?
Uncle Ben is somebody I respect a lot. Mm-hmm. He's done a great job for this country. I have deep admiration for him. But you see, I think it all comes to leadership. As you said, even twins will have their differences. Yeah. I am proud to say that we have a leader in President John Dramani Mahama, who is a unifier. Even if there were 20 factions, President Mahama will bring everybody together, and he's done that. And you can see the unison. You can see how we are not like our opponents who are, engaging in all kinds of things. And I don't want to even make people lose appetite tonight because of the things that have happened. But you haven't seen that happen in the NDC. It comes down to leadership. President Mahama has been such a fantastic leader, a unifier, and somebody who is able to bring everybody together. And that's what matters.
Mike, you have the last five.
Yes, thank you very much. We know that there are challenges everywhere. One thing that people should remember is that our party is structured in a way that when we are in opposition, the flag bearer has no say over party matters. And there's one thing that some people keep confusing. They don't understand MPP. We don't allow our flag bearer to tell us what to do. We don't allow our flag bearer to tell us who to vote for as general secretary. Those who wanted Kwame Jepon wanted him. And so if, for example, we want to remove Kwame Jepon, it is not our flag bearer who will tell us who to remove. We have our own mind who to vote and who to remove.
Right.
So anybody who tries to add Nana Akufo-Addo to decision-making in MPP is either ignorant or mischievous.
All right. Thank you very much, Michael Kwe Jr., Deputy Director of Communications for the New Patriotic Party. Sam Okwujeto Ablakwa.
You know the animal, the ostrich?
Yes.
Okay. That's all I have to say.
Okay.
You know the camel?
Deputy Minister of Education. Sam, I wish you all the best in the elections. But
thank
of course,
you.
We'll be seeing you here
thank
again.
You.
And Michael Kwe, of course, wish you all the best as well for
thank
the NPP. Right, so that's it. Thank you to iCandy for my outfit this evening. And of course, I was styled by Akosua V. Have a very beautiful evening, everyone.